Welcome to Brains Matter, the podcast on science, curiosities, and general knowledge. I'm your host, just an ordinary guy. Hello everyone, and welcome to the science election special of Brains Matter. For those overseas, Australia's having an election this weekend, and in the lead up to the election, I didn't hear very much said about science or education. So on my website, if you go to www.brainsmatter.com, I put down an open letter to the Australian political parties, and I'll just start off by reading through that so you can all hear what I've said. We have a curious situation in Australia. Members of society who commit offences can still be seen as heroes and end up in sporting halls of fame. All is forgiven in the name of sporting entertainment, and these individuals earn hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of dollars. If you walk up to the average Australian and ask the name of the captain of Australia's cricket team, it'd be odds on if you were to wager that they would know the answer. Ask those same individuals to name an Australian Nobel laureate, however, and the number of correct responses would drop dramatically. For the record, Elizabeth Blackburn in 2009, Barry Marshall and Robin Warren in 2005, and Peter Doherty in 1996 were the most recent. Even if one were to put aside internationally recognised awards just for a moment, think of all the doctors, teachers, scientists and researchers who make a difference to your life. The medicines and procedures used to save your grandparents in hospital, the Wi-Fi that you're using to log onto the internet right now, the electricity you use to light and heat or cool your home, all of this is available to us thanks to science and research. People who do this for a living are the real heroes. In the meantime, our educational institutions such as universities are suffering, and the quality of education and quality of graduates, anecdotally, not what it used to be as a result. The general public don't seem to be as well versed in the sciences as they ought to. A prime example of this is the denial of climate change in this country, under the incorrect guise of scepticism from some corners. Of course, there's a huge vested interest in some of the deniers, but a large proportion of the deniers actually do not seem to fathom the scientific method, which was seen to be the only way to believe their claims. Barack Obama said, "At such a difficult moment," referring to the global financial crisis in April 2009, "there are those who say we cannot afford to invest in science, that support for research is somehow a luxury. I fundamentally disagree. Science is more essential for our prosperity, our security, our health, our environment, and our quality of life than it has ever been before." So let's quickly delve into some facts about education, science, and research in Australia. An Australian university graduate pays, on average, twice as much tax as other Australians. The US, UK, China, India, Australia and Denmark governments all recognise the link between science research and economic prosperity. Public funding for education in Australia has been cut, and if we spend $37 billion each year for 10 years on sustainable resources, our energy would be free forever. You can read the rest of that post at the Brains Matter website and you'll see the list of questions there, but we'll get onto that soon. What I did after writing that post is I emailed every single politician with an email address listed on the Senate ticket in Victoria. So the parties I contacted included the Australian Labor Party, the Liberal Party of Australia, the Australian Greens, Family First, the Socialist Equity Party, Senator Online, Democratic Labor Party, Australian Democrats, Shooters and Fishers Party, Australian Sex Party, the Climate Skeptics, Socialist Alliance, Citizens Electoral Council, Building Australia, One Nation, the National Party, Christian Democratic Party, Secular Party of Australia, Carers Alliance and the Liberal Democrats. And in addition to that, I also contacted a number of politicians and parties online as well. And you can see a link to the references that I used in that particular letter on that post as well. And to go through some of the responses with me, I have Bec Crew. You may recall my pleas for votes a little while ago for the National Science Week Big Blog Theory competition. I was nominated somehow in the microblogging category. Well, Bec was nominated in the blogging category, and guess what, everyone? She won. So welcome to the show, Bec.
Thank you.
First up, though, I talked to Dr. Karl about his views on science in Australia and the political view of science as well, and I actually have a response from Dr. Karl, and I'll read through that in particular because he did mention the election, and he sent me an email. "Howdy again, it was a lot of fun to work with you. The election, the level of debate, quote, quote, makes me weep. I love your open letter, Karl." And so, that being said, here's his interview. With me today, I've got Karl Kruszelnicki, better known as Dr. Karl. So welcome to the show, Dr. Karl.
Dr. Prasad, thank you.
Well, you're probably seen as the foremost expert in science communication in Australia. And one of the things that National Science Week is trying to do is promote the wonders and fascination that science can bring to everybody's lives. So do you think that there's an actual lack of interest in science in Australia? Why do you think we need a National Science Week?
Well, I think it's part of a bigger picture, which is a lack of appreciation and respect for education.
Mm-hmm.
We do not respect education for what it can give us and the people who deliver it to us, the educators, the teachers.
Mm-hmm.
And I first became aware of this, really obvious way, when I was coming back from the Himalayas with a bunch of school kids. They were from my son's Sydney Boys High School,
mm-hmm.
and they were all giant young men rowers. And so we came out of the Himalayas, made our way to the feeder airport at Bangkok, went to the group check-in because there was a group of us, and presented myself to the counter. And the woman behind the counter said, "Oh, are these school children? Mm-hmm. You know, they're all 2 meters tall." I said, "Yeah." And she said, "Are you a school teacher?" And it was a bit complicated, so I said, "Yeah, I'm a school teacher, taking the easy way out." And she said, "Oh, well, in that case, I'll see if I can upgrade you to business class."
Fantastic.
Now, nobody would think of that in Australia. Or in America, or in England. Nobody in any of the Western countries, apart from the Scandinavian ones,
mm-hmm.
would have any respect for a teacher and would say, "Oh, you're a teacher, are you? Oh, well, look here, look, you take my parking spot in the supermarket. Or here, you take my line in the queue to see Evil Dead 23 rip the guts out of a young bunch of kids in a house who are eating pizza on a weekend with their girlfriends."
Mm-hmm.
Or nobody does that except for the Scandinavian countries and several of the poor countries.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's the fundamental problem, that we do not respect educators, and that's why Science Week is part of the overall picture. So it's not just science, there's other things as well.
I do recall when I visited India probably about a decade or so ago now, being an educator, a teacher or a university lecturer is seen as the pinnacle of careers that you could achieve.
So it should be.
If you're a lawyer, it's like, okay. If you're a doctor, that's better because you're helping people. But if you're a teacher,
You're liberating people. You're helping them go to a better place. But in Australia and in most of the Western countries, we've thought, oh, people want an education. Well, let's charge them for it.
Mm.
Instead of realising that it's a benefit to the society. For example, in Australia, 16% of the population have university degrees. They pay 32% of the tax. Mate, if they're educated, they benefit the community. In Scandinavian countries, it is considered normal that you will go to at least a master's degree, and even if you are from a foreign country, they will still pay for your education, even mm-hmm. if you're a foreigner, to go to university level to master's at least.
So why do you think there's that difference in perception from some countries to what we experience here?
Because our government doesn't lead. It doesn't govern.
Mm.
Our government is in a search for popularity combined with, like most governments, subject to big business. You know, it doesn't matter which government you're talking about. ALP just means another Liberal Party.
Mm.
They're both the same. They're all branches of the same party, which is the Property Party, which is designed to protect the interests of people with property. And so a good example of where you can see that the governments are not governing is with regard to climate change. They'll do something.
This is a bugbear for me.
Yeah, well, they'll do something about climate change only when something bad happens to the wealthy countries. It doesn't matter if it happens to poor people. You know, the standard thing, there's been a terrible bus or train accident in India and 1,000 Indians were killed and one American. Or whatever, right?
Mm.
So nothing will happen, and the governments will not govern until something bad, until something really bad happens.
So the 4-year policy views that tend to happen within government. I know someone who worked in government, and he said a party will put something into place if they can get the credit for it within 4 years.
That,
and because climate change is a long term solution, they're not interested.
That's right. They're not. It's a shame the governments won't govern anymore.
So, given that that's the case, what can we do in terms of communicating science, getting people better aware of what's going on?
Let them become aware of the scientific process. Let them know that science is one truly magnificent tool for understanding the universe around you,
mm-hmm.
That it teaches you to have critical thinking, skeptical thinking, to look at the facts. And as Faraday said, I hold my theories on the tips of my fingers so the merest breath of fact will blow them away.
Mm-hmm.
And as the facts change, if you get more data, adjust to it. But at least do that.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas we don't seem to be running too much of the population on that. And the more we can do for the population to educate them about science and how it's a good tool for this. It's not a good tool for falling in love, but it is a good tool for example, helping work out where your country wants to go. Mm-hmm. In Australia, about 80% of our income comes from science and technology-related products and devices and copyright and intellectual property.
And even just that 80% of our income comes from that, yet Australian populations are just about to have an election for those who are overseas listening.
Mm-hmm.
I have not heard to date anything positive or any policies put out about education or science or research. The only one I've heard is from the opposition who've said they're going to cut funding to tertiary institutions, and to me that doesn't make sense.
Well, what my brain cannot formulate words. All I can do is agree with you that it doesn't make sense. It is an investment in the future. Have you been to Singapore?
I've been through Singapore.
Oh, the schools there are wonderful. Mm. The teachers are respected and the students are expected to do well at school. And the schools are magnificent.
In India, if you walk up to someone, here it's not quite seen to be as polite, I guess, if you walk up to someone and say, what's your highest level of education? It's almost seen as an insult because so many people don't have degrees and so on. But there, if you walk up to someone and you say, what do you do? I'm a doctor or I'm a computer scientist or whatever else. And and it's just part of society, they'll say, so where did you get your degree? What level of degree did you go to? And if you have a master's or PhD, it is sudden awe.
Oh, and then people will even put on their certificates, on their CVs, MSc fail. I've seen that from an Indian student.
I haven't seen that one.
So they give it a go, which is good. If you don't fail, you don't do anything.
Yeah,
if you don't make a mistake, you don't make anything. Well, it's a very good way to learn, so long as you don't keep on making the same mistakes. So it's very good having Science Week now. I'm glad we've got Science Week. And I see it as a small part of the overall picture of educating the populace into critical thinking and being aware. Try and get some physics in there, because physics gives you a really good mental toolbox. Mm. So you know about the four forces of the universe. You won't get fooled when people say, if you put this energy bracelet on your hand, it'll improve your strength and give you better balance.
Or turn into a politician who says, I disbelieve every single climate scientist out there, and I know better.
Well, the statement that I found curious coming out of America was by a senator was, we've got to stop listening to the experts. Right, so you want a chef to repair the brakes on your car, and you want a car mechanic to cook your next meal in a restaurant? Well, you don't want experts, do you? Or you just don't want the experts that you don't particularly like.
Mm. I'm sorry, sir, you have cancer. We've got a great oncologist here. I don't believe I've got cancer.
It's heartbreaking. But hopefully what science does is teach you critical thinking.
For now, Bec and I are going to go through some of the responses from this particular post. And I actually had quite a bit of a feedback from the website. Was hit and inundated with zillions of hits from all around the world. I had someone from the New York Academy of Sciences comment on it, saying that she appreciated the attention that I was bringing to science in the Australian political campaign. Interestingly enough, quite a number of politicians responded both via Twitter, via email, and also via Facebook as well. So, Bec, let's start going through some of them.
So,
the first ones to reply, I had a response. This is from the Australian... We'll start off with the Australian Democrats. I guess that's possibly alphabetical order.
Yep.
This is from Rick Westgarth. The first question I put to all the politicians was, what is your personal view on the importance of science in society? The response there was, I think science is of utmost importance for many reasons. I think that Australia needs to be a smart country, as this will push us forward in the world. We'll not compete with other countries when it comes to the cost of production on so many items, but we can be the country that develops new technology. This cuts across many fields, but I think we should be world leaders in developing technology for the future in renewable energy and environmental sustainability. This would set Australia up economically as well. Question number two, the defence budget for 2010 to 2011 is almost $27 billion. How can we justify spending that much on defence, yet spend trivial amounts on research into renewable energy sources? Rick responds with, budgets are a hard question to answer, as I do not have access to the kinds of information that the major parties do. However, I can take your point about the divide between the spending. As my previous answer would suggest, I do believe we need to spend much more on R&D, as I feel this would be repaid to us in productivity in the future. As with so many things, I think we need to look to the future and stop playing around. We have come out of a GFC in good shape, and we should be looking to take advantage of our position. I hate to say this, but move forward as a country. Third question. According to the CIA World Factbook, we are number 85 in the world in terms of the amount of government money we put towards education in total. We spend 4.5% of our GDP on education. Science is obviously a much smaller subset, but we fall behind countries such as New Zealand on 6.2%, UK on 5.6%, US on 5.3%, Norway on 7.2%, Sweden on 7.1%, and even places such as Barbados, which have 6.9%, Botswana 8.7%, and Cuba 9.1%, and Yemen 9.6%. And many countries that contribute about the same or less as a percentage of GDP actually put in far more real funds in terms of amounts into education. How do you think this affects us in the education, science and research community, and what should be done about it? The response there is, I'm a strong believer in education for the future. Please read my bio and I'll put the link to that website that is linked there in this entry show notes. We should encourage our younger Australians to strive for more, and to do that, we need to give them an education system that offers every opportunity of success. So question four, what would you do to rectify the sense that most people in this country have about a lack of support for pure science and research without overhead such as the research quality framework and backing Australia's ability policy, which seemed not to have provided the benefits for which they were claimed when they were announced? Response was, this is not my area of expertise, but it seems to me that if a government backed programs fully, then Australians would see benefits. That would be enough to swing the public around to see how education and scientific advancement are worth our attention. Question 5. What is your view on fundamental research which has no immediate economic benefit, such as the work of Einstein, for which commercial benefits weren't available until the following century, but would not have been realised without his groundbreaking work? His response was, I do believe that science should not only be done when a clear outcome is evident. Science for the sake of science is a worthy pursuit for any country. Again, I'm not an expert, but as I understand it, the work with the collider has little or no known benefit, but it may open up new science that we don't even understand yet. Many great discoveries are in fact inventions that have happened when we are not trying to find them. Penicillin for one, and there are so many inventions in everyday life now that come from the race to the moon. So yes, fundamental research is a worthy pursuit. Question 6. What do you think should be done to promote science and science communication to the public? Again, a very hard question to answer, and I'll give you a non-science answer. Mainstream media. I think the best way is through science programming. Last question, number 7. Why do you think so few politicians seem to have a basic understanding of science? How shall we redress this issue? The answer he gave was, to the first part of your question, because they don't think it's a vote winner. I also believe that to many politicians only look at the current term and how they'll get re-elected, and this has been a beef of mine for years. I don't have a quick solution for this other than to say I do look to long-term factors of how to keep improving Australia. So I suppose the answer to the second part of your question is a bit cheeky. Vote for me. So what's your take on those responses there, Bec?
Oh, I mean, it seems he's got his head in the right place. I didn't get much sort of anything concrete, I don't think, from that response. It sort of seemed like it was a whole... There's a lot of philosophies there, and it does seem like he genuinely thinks that it is important, but I'm not sure if he was in a position to sort of make any concrete decisions or anything like that.
I think he's got his heart in the right place, and he understands the importance of science, which is really good to see. The answer about science communication. For me, this is a very personal issue, and I suppose it is for you as well, Bec.
Yeah.
When he says science communication through mainstream media.
Yeah.
The reason why I got into science communication is because mainstream media was so poor at doing it.
That's exactly true. And it's sort of, that kind of struck me in a sense that, you know, it would be great if mainstream media does cover science, but it doesn't. And to just kind of suggest that, that's what should happen isn't really going to help. We need ways of ensuring that it is on mainstream media and sort of ideas and how to get it. And that's sort of what I'd be looking for rather than just a suggestion to get it on mainstream media somehow.
There needs to be a policy of more funding going towards science education or science communication in particular. And I do know that with my own program, so this is sort of getting a little bit personal, I guess, but I've tried to apply for science funding quite a number of times, both at the federal and state level, and have been denied every single time. And it made me laugh because one of the responses I got was, podcasting doesn't count as science education.
Oh, no way.
So, and in the meantime, I'm getting, you know, letters from lots of people saying, you've influenced me to do this, or I'm going back to school because of this episode, or, you know, whatever else. And how is that not education?
Yeah. Well, it just kind of sounds like it's someone that doesn't really understand the medium at all. I mean, you can direct anyone to any of the science websites, you know, even like this big news websites, The Guardian, and that sort of thing. They all have their own science podcasts. So, you know, obviously this guy doesn't really know much about podcasts, if he's going to say that.
Well, I don't know if it was a male or female, but yeah. I'm assuming that whoever was reviewing the funding applications at the other end probably had a checklist from 1980 or something like that.
Yeah.
All right, so let's get on to the next response from the Democrats. So this is from Roger Howe, and I'll start going through his answers. Number one, personal view on science and society. His response was, I studied science at both school and university and believe that science forms a foundation block of our modern technological society. Question two, about justifying the defence budget in comparison to renewable energy. His response was, I couldn't justify this spending. Clearly, our most pressing problem is climate change and needs to be funded appropriately. Question three, about the percentage of GDP we spend. His response was, education is the basis of the progress of the country. Without it, we are left to be reliant on countries with better education programs. We are already seeing the effects of this, as we need to import skills to fill gaps that our education programs are not filling. The most advanced countries have vibrant research programs and science and engineering education pathways. So question four, about the perceived lack of support of pure science research in this country. He responds with, I would work with the research institutes and universities to build a better understanding of their contribution to Australian society and to point out the major losses to Australia over the years. For example, Australia at the forefront of computing and solar research in the early days of both, but let overseas interests buy them out or overtake us. Question five, on fundamental research, for example, Einstein. Fundamental research is the building blocks of the next generation of advances. If you're not in that space, how can you build on it? So question six, about science communication. I know of various school programs, and through my involvement in Rotary, I know they sponsor some programs, but the wider public don't seem to understand the importance of science in society, for example, climate change. People are still mistakenly saying there's no clear science. I think there needs to be a senior minister for science, and I think the government can then take scientific advice into account across all cabinet decisions. And last question. Why do you think so few politicians seem to have a basic understanding of science, and how should we redress it? I have a professional career in IT, also with training in teaching, a real-world job. Many politicians seem to come from service industries such as lawyers, unions, or political parties, and seem to have lost a wider viewpoint in the relevance of science to the economy, to education, and to society. Thanks for the opportunity to respond. So how do you feel about those responses there from Roger Howe?
I like the idea of the science minister.
Not just a science minister, a senior science minister.
Yeah, I think it's a really good idea just to have the constant presence there to, you know, monitor things and to actually have an education in science and be able to communicate that while everybody else is focusing on other things. I think it's a really important thing to have, and it's surprising that that isn't something that we already have.
We have a chief scientist, but I think that's only in an advisory role.
Yeah, it's sort of, I mean, that's wonderful, but yeah, it'd be great to have someone that can, I guess, have more of an influence, I suppose.
The thing out of this particular response that I really like is that he says, I think the government can then take scientific advice into account across all cabinet decisions, and I think that's really fundamental because there are so many decisions that are made and have been made over the past, you know, 10, 15 years, where the average person with a basic understanding of science will look at it and going, are these people fools? How come they came up with that idea?
Yeah, it's true.
I do get a very strong sense of a really good understanding of the importance of science from this response here. I've also had one other response from the Australian Democrats, but that was in the form of an actual interview, so I'll play that after Bec and I finished with going through some of the other stuff. There was a comment from James on the website who actually put in an extra question to say, any parties want to comment on the support of the next immediate generation of scientists? PhD students receive a stipend of $22,500 per year tax-free, but it has been pointed out that these people were working full-time, 40 hours a week, and probably much more. They received no employer superannuation and weren't entitled to concessions or pensions. Given that these students will be the scientists of the future, is it worth supporting them rather than leaving them below the poverty line? That's actually a really good question. Here are these people doing fundamental research, going to be really important for future economic benefit of Australia through their research and anything that pops out of it. Would you be happy sitting on $22,500 a year for, you know, the life of your PhD?
Absolutely not. I mean, it's a case of I was thinking about when it comes to female scientists, and I'm working at Cosmos at the moment, and there was an article written by a female scientist, and she said that it's still a case of having to choose between the two. If you wanted to do a PhD, you can't have a family because it's just so much work and there's just not that much money, and you can't afford to have someone help you look after your kids. And, you know, you're always looking for grants and you can't get grants, and there's so much competition between students to get funding. And it's a really big struggle. And, you know, if you do get money, it's really low paying and you don't have time to do extra work and earn extra money. So it's really tough, and it's just really insulting to these people who are, you know, obviously doing such great work.
You know, it takes me back to high school when people were saying, so what do you want to do after school? And all of the kids who did really well and got A's and all the rest of it, they all said, I want to be a doctor, or I want to be a lawyer, or something else. And the reason why, and, you know, this is something that I've always wondered about, the reason why is because they're all high-paid jobs.
Yeah.
If you were a doctor or a lawyer and your salary topped out at $70,000, then be interesting to see what the percentage of people that would change their mind about their future career would be.
Yeah, exactly.
I also get the sense that people who go into a research career or an academic career, a lot of them do it because they absolutely love doing it, not because of the pay, because the pay is pretty bad. And I can say this as a part-time academic and someone who works in industry as well, is that if I had a choice between an academic pay and a private industry pay, there'd be no way on earth I'd go to an academic pay.
Yeah.
In response to that, Anthony David, who's also from the Australian Democrats, whose interview I'll play soon, responded to that particular question with a quote from the Election Action Plan. So this is directly from one of their policies. Peg student income support measures, including off study and youth allowance, to the Henderson poverty line, and lower the age of independence for students to 18 years. And he's got a link there to the Election Action Plan, which I'll put into the show notes as well. The scholarships are an annual income support measure, but like many other allowances, quote, do not attract superannuation obligations. So I'll put that link up for people to look at, and you can make your own mind up about what that means to you. Next is a response from Fiona Patton, who is from the Australian Sex Party. Her response was, thank you for taking the time to contact us regarding our policies. Unfortunately, due to our party's youth, we haven't had the time to formulate policies on all the issues facing Australia today. However, we do believe greatly in the importance of science, and as such, all of our existing policies and those to come with the product of scientific research and not emotion-based knee-jerk reactions. Once again, we thank you for your interest, and as soon as I've the time, I'll answer your questions directly. So I guess from that one, it was probably a case of, given that it's the last few days before the election, is possibly a case of, don't have time now, but I think science is important and I'll get back to you later.
Yeah. I mean, at least they're honest.
Yeah. So we've done the Australian Democrats, we've done the Australian Sex Party. Now let's go on to the Australian Greens, being alphabetical here in the responses. So here is a response. The Greens are actually quite organised. I did say in my original email and post that only required one set of responses if there was a consensus view within the party. And the Greens responded, it was from Janet Rice, but also sent on behalf of Richard Di Natale and Sylvia Sagni. I hope I've pronounced that right. Apologies if I haven't. So here's a response from them, but primarily from Janet. She replies, my answers are short, sorry. Time is the essence in these last few days. Understandable, given that the election's not that far away. As a preamble, I'm a science graduate with honours in meteorology from Melbourne Uni. My partner is one of Australia's leading climate change researchers. My eldest son has just started a science degree at Melbourne. And here are the responses from the Greens. Personal view of science and society, incredibly important. It's a framework that makes sense of the world and provides a rational basis for how to live our lives. Number two, how can we justify spending the amount of money on defence, yet trivial amounts on renewable energy? Very short and to the point response, we can't and we shouldn't. Question three, about the percentage of GDP we spend on education. There needs to be an increase in funding for education overall and for science education. I have two children now, 15 and 18, one with a particular aptitude for and interest in science, the other much more inclined towards communication and humanities. They've both attended state, primary and high schools. I think the level of scientific literacy in the school system is not high enough. Science needs to be both taught as separate subjects, but a scientific outlook needs to be woven into other parts of the curriculum. I think improving the teaching of science and its relevance in all our teacher training would be an essential element of this. There needs to be better skills in making the connections between creativity, curiosity and science, and imparting an understanding that almost all the big issues that we are facing can benefit from a scientific approach. And the difference between a scientific approach and a non-scientific approach, e.g. why astronomy is a science and astrology is not. So question four, what would you do to rectify the sense that most people in this country have about lack of support for science and research? Response, I think the lack of support is symptomatic of the overall lack of understanding about science in our community. There needs to be a systematic program to improve this before we see much change. Question five, view on fundamental research. This needs to be properly supported. The current frameworks of both academia and within CSIRO do not do this well enough. Far too many bureaucratic hoops focused on measurable outputs. There doesn't seem to be accountability for public money, but the current accountability frameworks generally aren't well suited for fundamental research as far as I can see. Question six on science communication. There's obviously a role for much more serious work on science education and communication with the general public. I'm no expert as to what form this should take. It needs to go beyond Dr. Carl and Mythbusters. I think there's an opportunity to make more use of social networking media. And a final question, a question about politicians and their understanding of science. It's because most politicians are drawn from a narrow set of professions and backgrounds and have not received a good science education in our educational systems. See above my comments about weaving science throughout the curriculum and ensuring good understanding and appreciation of science by all teachers and on science communication. What's your take on the Greens' response there?
I liked the science communication. The idea is that it does have to go beyond, you know, just a couple of, I guess you could say, call them celebrities doing their bit. So if they're doing social media, sounds like a really great idea, and you know, it would work, I think. So it's good that someone's actually thought that much about it, and it'd be great to be, you know, be able to see that actually be implemented.
You know, I get a very strong sense from this particular response that there is that appreciation for the importance of science, and you know, a very blunt response to, you know, that the question about justifying how much we spend on some things versus other things which mm-hmm. are going to influence our future. You know, the very direct response is we shouldn't try and justify it. And yeah. I think that also says a fair bit about the view within the party as well.
Yeah.
They're talking about increase in funding for science and education in general. And in terms of the science communication stuff, it's good that they've talked about new media because, you know, once again, something close to your heart and mind, that's the space we play in as well. So it's good to see that there is a party that actually recognises the importance of that.
Yeah, I mean, it's sort of, it's surprising it that they would sort of bring that up, I guess, just in a sense of it seems like it's a really forward thing. And, you know, I wouldn't really think that many parties at this stage would be talking about social media in science. So I think it's a really good thing.
Okay, now let's get on to the response from the Labor Party. The Labor Party, they responded to me via Twitter. So whoever was the official Twitterer for the Australian Labor Party, and this was after a little bit of coaxing, shall we say. There wasn't actually any responses to any of the questions, but a few broad statements. And there were three statements, and I'll just read them out. We believe science is crucial to our future, and the Gillard government aims to build skills in science. And then there's a link to a policy. Second statement, innovation is improving lives by increasing our capacity to generate and apply new ideas, and a link to their innovation policy. And then the final statement, you can read more in our policies on science, innovation and research. And they've given a couple of other links to a couple of other policies there as well. And I'll put all those links up. I do realise that they are quite a large party, and as a result, people tend to have to conform to the party line and might not be allowed to speak to the media as much. Now, they're saying some, you know, fairly motherhood statements there about, yes, science is good. Having read through the policies and stuff, they did have a section in there about funding for science communication in particular. That I don't know what the exact split of that funding is going to be, but apart from it just seems like a few very general statements to me.
Yeah, I mean, that's sort of, I think that's been the case with a lot of the policies that have been going around. It's just so hard to get anything concrete out of them whatsoever, and it just makes it so hard to sort of make a decision on anything, because it's, you know, you need something concrete and nobody's really giving anything yet. So I think it's really difficult.
Okay, so that was a very quick one. We'll now get on to, and for those overseas, the current Australian government is led by the Labor Party, and that's the response we just read out then. The way the Australian political scene operates is it's similar to the US. There are two main parties, and they're seen as the main parties because they've got the most number of representatives in the House of, most number of seats in the House of Representatives, and historically, over the last, you know, 30 or 40 years anyway, prime ministers have almost always come from either the Labor or Liberal Party. The Liberal Party are in a coalition with the National Party, and so the Liberal Nationals are basically one unit. The Greens are seen as the third party at the moment because they've got five senators. The Democrats, who we started off with, used to be the third biggest party. They had up to nine senators at one point, and they were the third major party. They kind of faded a little bit in the last couple of elections, but they're back now. And most of the other parties that we're going to go through are quite small parties or independents, individual people, independents as well. So that being said, I'll get on to the Liberal response. And this response is from Alan Tudge, who is the Liberal candidate for Aston in Victoria. And his response is, thanks for writing to me in relation to my position on science. I do not have the time to answer all your questions before your deadline. However, let me say that I believe that science is fundamental to the future health and prosperity of Australia. Yes, we need to continue to invest government money into science and education, but we also need to get the best value from it. Australia does very well in international student tests, typically ranking just below the very top cluster of countries. If there was one thing to inspire more people into science, I think it would be to enhance the quality of science teaching in our schools. Regards, Alan. So what's your take on that one?
I don't know. It's sort of the standard response without getting much out of him, really.
I did reply to it to say, I understand that you're pressed for time at the moment, but I'd look forward to your full responses when you do have some time. So if I do get some full responses, then I'll post those up and put it on a future podcast. But that response is very similar to the Labor response, I think, at the moment.
It's sort of exactly the sort of science is great. Don't really have time to go into any more details. Whether they do have anything else concrete, I'm not sure. But, yeah, they're definitely not forthcoming.
It's interesting to hear that response where Alan actually says, we do need to continue to invest government money into science and education. Yet, at the same time, in The Australian on August the 18th, there was a report that said, the coalition saw public investment in science as a possible saving rather than an investment, the country's peak researcher body warned on Tuesday. An incoming coalition government could cut vital funding to Australia's high-profile public research agencies, said the Federation of Australian Scientific and Technological Societies chief, Anna Maria Arabia. And if you look up the Australian website, you'll be able to find that article. It's called No Extra Research Funding, Says Coalition. So I don't know whether that's a personal view from this particular candidate versus the party view, or whether the report in The Australian hasn't quite got the facts right, but I encourage the listeners out there to actually go up and read the science policy or ask their local member what their actual view is. You know, apart from what's said there, which is your standard statement, I'm just a little bit confused based on what's said there versus what's being reported.
I'm inclined to sort of trust that article. It did seem like he was trying to be sort of diplomatic, I guess, and, you know, obviously he's not going to say to the science website, science is great, but unfortunately we're cutting in funding.
We're
cutting back on it and that sort of thing. So, yeah, I don't know. I think maybe he felt he was in a tough position as well, given that he probably knew that policy, if that article is true. Mm. So, yeah, I think it's sort of tough to get things out of people. Oh, especially with the Labor Party, the Liberal Party, I guess it would be tough to get something out of anybody, knowing that they had that policy.
And it's very interesting because the election pundits say it's going to be line ball and a very close election. Some people are talking about a hung parliament. And I've got a lot of feedback from people to say, the answers to your questions is going to affect my vote. So it's not in the interests of any of the parties, especially the two major parties or what are considered to be major parties, not to answer them fully.
Mm.
All right, now let's get on to the Secular Party of Australia. And the candidate for the Secular Party of Australia did say that they didn't have enough time, but she gave me a reasonably full email response, and I'll just go through that. Thank you for the opportunity to impress on you how important science is to me personally. As you can appreciate, I'm pushed for time this close to the election, but I hope this response will suffice. I was trained as a scientist, Bachelor of Science, Diploma of Education at the University of Queensland, and my first job was as a science and mathematics teacher. Science has been my first and only lifelong love. I suppose you could say that my family profession is science. For the last 10 years or so of my working life, I worked as a tax consultant in the area of research and development tax concession, and was very disappointed when the Howard government began to wind back the value of the concession, and with it, the incentive for companies to engage in R&D. By the way, for the overseas listeners, the Howard government was the former government, which was the Liberal National Coalition. And I'll continue on. I believe passionately in the importance and value of science and scientific research, both pure and applied, and especially in the need for good science education and science and maths teachers. I don't think enough is done to encourage good people into teaching science, or that enough value is placed on the role of science teachers. I'm appalled at the lack of scientific literacy in the community in general, and in the Parliament in particular. I'm also passionate about rationality and reason, the importance of credible, reproducible evidence, and the need to base solutions to problems firmly on these principles. It is of great concern to me to see the enduring prevalence of superstitious beliefs and the trust placed in pseudoscience, including unproven alternative medicine therapies. Homeopathy is my own personal pet hate, yet so many people believe in its efficacy without any supporting evidence for its effectiveness beyond that of the placebo effect. I've been an active member of the Australian Skeptics for many years, and then she's given a link to her bio. So even though she didn't go through a question-by-question response, I think she actually did respond to the majority of questions within that email.
Yeah, I mean, it's sort of, it was good to see someone so sort of forthcoming, and obviously with science being her first love, or kind of what the exact phrase was. But, I mean, it sounds wonderful. But, yeah, I mean, it's sort of a case of what influence can this party have, being such a small party. It's sort of, it's almost like it's fantastic that she would have these views and be so excited about science and skepticism and that sort of thing. But yeah, it's just hard to sort of share the enthusiasm when you're not really sure how influential she'll, you know, this party will ever be.
But I think part of that comes down to public perception, because if enough people believed in what she said and voted for her, then she would either have a balance of power, or possibly like some of the independents have had in the past, or if enough people vote for that party. There's a sense in Australian society that the government is going to be Labor or Liberal, but there's nothing stopping people from voting for someone else, and if they get the same percentage, then they would form government.
Sure.
So what we're talking about is a cultural, historical thing, and people following that same behavioural pattern as opposed to what can actually happen, because there's nothing to actually stop the secular party from forming government, or the Democrats, or the Greens, or the Nationals by themselves, or you know any of the others, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it'd be fantastic. I don't know. I remain pessimistic, I suppose.
So you're taking the pragmatic approach, are you?
Yep.
So, you know, those were the bulk of responses, and I'll go through the parties that didn't respond. Family First, Socialist Equity Party, Centre Online, Democrat Labor Party, Shooters and Fishers, Climate Skeptics, Socialist Alliance, Building Australia, One Nation, The Nationals, Christian Democratic Party, Carers Alliance, or the Liberal Democrats. So, listeners, take out of that what you will. And here's the interview that I did with Anthony David, who is a Senate candidate for the Australian Democrats in Canberra. Anthony David is a Senate candidate for the Australian Democrats in the Australian Capital Territory in the 2010 federal election. Anthony's from Canberra and has a background in IT, and has publicly made the statement, "Effective education at all ages is the cornerstone of our civil society. I'm particularly concerned about the shortage of science and mathematics teachers. I want to see people trained in these fields take up the profession, especially primary teaching where the foundations are set. The federal government has a vital role in the development and deployment of these resources." And I'd like to welcome Anthony to the show.
Thank you.
So, Anthony, to start off with, what was your motivation for that statement?
Well, I've my personal observations I've got three grown-up children that they've moved through all the sectors of education, and also I have friends who are teachers, and I've spoken to people involved in curriculum development. For example, I had a friend of mine who was a teacher in high school. She became a primary school teacher because she was a maths teacher. And she realised that most of the damage in maths education was happening in primary school, because there weren't enough role models, especially for females in primary school, for young girls in particular, and young boys, to engage with mathematics and science in general.
And that fits in very closely with what science author Simon Singh said to me. So for those listeners who haven't heard that episode, go back to episode 100. Where he was talking about what motivated him was his teachers. And he went back and decided to teach in some public schools in Britain and found that there are a lot of schools which actually didn't have people qualified to teach it. And the comment he made was that if you're a 10-year-old and your teacher doesn't have an interest or passion for what they're teaching you, then you're not going to get that interest or passion either, are you?
That's correct. I think back to my own experience. I still remember on one of my report cards from my grade four teacher saying, "Anthony needs to concentrate on the basics and not on a university education at this level," because I was passionate about science at an early age, and a lot of that got knocked out of me for quite a while, to be honest. So I don't want to see that sort of attitude pervading in the education system. Hopefully, most teachers are more enlightened than that.
Mm-hmm. So what do you think the general science literacy is within the government?
If you have a look through the list of qualifications in the federal parliament, you might find one with a science degree. I think he's got a physics degree. He also happens to be a climate change denier, so which is pretty tragic.
And you've actually got a background in science, don't you?
That's correct. Back in the late 70s, when it was free education, I enrolled at Adelaide University in and studied botany, zoology, and computer science. It was a little bit like pearls before swine. A young man, not quite sure what he was going to do, so I almost got a degree, moved to Canberra, and got into the IT industry and had what I think was a pretty successful career. I then came across the salinity report on the Murray-Darling Basin in 1999. And I was flipping through it and I thought, oh my God. You know, we knew about the science of this, you know, decades ago. So I thought, why has it just degraded so much? So that was the first spark in my mind. The next one was the internet filter. I became involved with Australian Democrats, ran in the local assembly election, then heard this term being bandied around among government called sustainability. And at that stage, I was at a state in my career when I was getting a bit jaded with the IT industry, and I was looking around. I was sitting on the mud flats at Cairns looking around. I thought, well, there's no cubicles here. I didn't go to university to end up in a cubicle for the rest of my life. So I looked around to enrol in a science degree. And I looked around all around Australia, and right in my backyard at the ANU was a Bachelor of Science in Resource and Environmental Management. For 7.5 years, I did part-time study and full-time work. And people would say, well, what are you doing it for? I said, to learn stuff. And there's going to be so many things out there that I don't understand and don't know about that I'll naturally discover and find things that will be interested. And sure enough, that's what happened. So I started out with a course plan, and that was revised over 50 times. So in the end, I end up doing things I didn't do in my first attempt at a degree, and I end up specialising in earth science and mathematics. I did the mathematics because if you're doing science and you don't do mathematics, you're certainly limiting yourself. I'm not a great mathematician, but I've certainly I did end up majoring in it, and I actually used that in my honours research, modelling geochemical cycles over the last ice age. So that's my background. Briefly, that's my background in science.
So you're probably one of the few people, if elected to the Senate, who would have a background in a sustainability kind of area, wouldn't you?
That's correct. That was the beauty of the what I call the REM degree, was that it looked at not just the science, you know, like what this intractable problem, why are things, environmental issues, not being solved? And you know, when the science is often so black and white, but there's economic issues, there's social issues, there's political issues, there's cultural issues that are valid things when you're dealing with people. So it's often seen as a bit wishy-washy sometimes to look at the social science, but it's so important to incorporate that when you're looking at developing policy based on science.
So what do you think we can do about encouraging people with a science background into government? Because one of the bugbears I have is that there seem to be a lot of decisions made by politicians who don't have a background in basic science. You know, you can forgive that if they get the right kind of advice, but a few seem to take the advice of people who aren't experts over those who are experts, and I find that very frustrating.
It is frustrating, but I think that that's not just in science. I think that's across a wide range of issues. And I had a brief exchange on Twitter with Alam Shahar. He raised a question at the first Reith lecture about science education and the fact that the people who are actually on the ground in the field actually don't get listened to it as much as people who agree with the person who's asking the question.
Yeah.
And I think that's human nature. And overcoming that is, I think it comes down to education. Like there was a recent Occam's Razor interview talking about, was this a teacher in Queensland teaching rational thought in high school? I think that's a fantastic foundation for understanding information.
Yeah, so it's more about understanding the scientific method. You don't have to understand the actual facts of science, but
yep,
you need to understand the scientific method, which will help you make decisions about every aspect of life.
Exactly, exactly.
How do you feel about so many of our top scientists leaving Australia because of a perceived lack of opportunity here? Personally, I know dozens of people who would fit into that boat as well.
Certainly. Yes, there is a disparity in income, in opportunities. I see a lot of people looking at where they are in their career in Australia, and they say, look overseas. I guess with the global financial crisis is sort of taking the edge off a lot of positions in the United States in particular. It comes down to how much they're paid, the workload, like there's teaching, there's administration, and there's research. And finding that balance, the administration load, from what I can see, is rising on the academic staff and then teaching staff, when you also see the admin part of a university actually expanding. So it's quite a bit of a paradox there. I think there's more accountability, which is good, but you can often spend a lot of time, more time filling in forms, accounting for, say, spending $6,000 than it takes to either apply for it or actually use that money. So there is that underlying frustration in how things are managed, which can drive people overseas as well.
So what should we be doing about science in this country?
I think politicians love getting the silver spade out, digging it in the ground and say, we're building something. You don't see them often turning up to say, we've just hired these fantastic people and getting photo opportunities with that. You know, hiring people is a recurrent cost, whereas the building is a capital cost, which can be quickly forgotten in the next budget. But a recurrent cost just hangs around for a long time. Maybe if they treated the academic staff as assets rather than liabilities.
What's your view on fundamental research which has no immediate economic benefit, such as the work of Einstein, relativity and so on, for which commercial benefits weren't available until the following century, but they would never have been realised without this groundbreaking work? And the reason I ask that is because anecdotally I've heard from researchers in universities that a lot of the fundamental research isn't promoted as much anymore, and this has happened over the past 10 years or so because there is a perceived need based on the funding model to have some kind of economic output.
Yes. It's rather curious. The mantra over the last 10 years has also, when it comes to supporting business development, they always say, we don't want to pick winners. However, when it comes to science, they're using that same picking winners logic. When it comes to supporting science grants, they say, well, we're looking for applied applications. The insane thing is touting the recent, the patents on wireless. Mm-hmm. That didn't come out of someone thinking, oh, wireless is really cool. Let's find out how to make it better. It came out of astrophysics, right, looking at managing radio frequencies. Mm-hmm. So that was fundamental basic research that had these unintended consequences. I mean, you've got an IT background. You're certainly well aware of this obscure mathematician in the 20s and 30s who developed this theory of finite state automata. I mean, what practical application could that be at all? And Alan Turing went on to, it was the foundation of modern computing.
Yeah, so without Alan Turing, we wouldn't have had state machines or anything like that, and the fact that we're talking via computers right now wouldn't have happened.
Exactly. So it's just fundamental. Bell Labs is a classic example in the 70s and 80s in the US, and they're actually a private, and Xerox PARC was another one. Two private labs just revolutionized the way Western society and hopefully developing countries as well operate and communicate with each other. So it's essential.
Given that we've basically agreed that there should be more of a focus on science, especially at the early levels with primary teaching and so on, a support for tertiary research because that will give us great economic benefits. One thing that leads down to is the communication aspect. Science isn't communicated that much or that well in this country at the moment. For example, when the Australian cricket team won the Ashes, they were ticker tape parades in every capital city in the country. But when Barry Marshall and Robin Warren won the 2005 Nobel Prize, it was like a page three small article. And Elizabeth Blackburn won last year. That was reported a bit more because she was female, but it still wasn't to the same level. So what do you think we should be doing about science communication in this country?
Well, two things. I think maybe we should start a lobby group to for the next Nobel Prize winner to have a ticker tape parade and start pestering politicians to recognise them more. I think that's important and get a media campaign, because as you say, as we were talking earlier, the media love moving things that are bright, shiny objects that are controversial. And science is not seen as bright, shiny object. It's just, you know, nerdy and not mainstream. So we need to be better at developing a media presence. Obviously, the ABC does a wonderful job with the science show and Occam's Razor and other shows. But there's of course Catalyst. But on the commercial side of things, it's not so well emphasised, and that needs to change. We can't just sit in an ABC ghetto. It needs to be attract the attention of the wider community. And that'll attract the attention of politicians, and it'll snowball on from there. As far as details of that campaign, I'm not sure. The other thing with science communication is that a lot of universities do have specialist, including the ANU, have specialist science communication courses under Bachelor of Science. So it's good to see graduates coming out of there. It'd be good to see them making an impact in the wider community.
There's been a little bit of a focus on science communication lately, because there's, of course, National Science Week, which it is this week, and things like the big blog theory competition and so on. But they all seem quite small in comparison to what the media focuses on, generally speaking.
Yep. Yes, speaking of the Science Week, it's rather frustrating having it on during the election times. I don't think I've gone to anything, which is sad. We should be a maritime nation. We're girt by sea, but our understanding of our oceans and our sea is pretty paltry. Our investment in research vessels, certainly we do have, there is a project for a new research vessel, oceanographic research vessel. But again, that's a capital budget, and I'd like to see an assurance that there'll be enough recurrent funding to keep it afloat and keep it all the research projects that can be done there achieved. Things like there's the next ocean drilling project, which we're looking at committing to beyond 2013, and that has enormous impacts on how we understand even things like mineral exploration on the surface of Australia. So you can't just say it's just blue sky research. It does have practical spin-offs. So it's important that these projects be identified, and not just, you know, we talked about the flagship projects, the CSIRO, and also backing Australia's ability. I do like to say is that a couple of points which we haven't touched on is the role of private sector in science. Things like this, and there's two things which I think are sadly lacking, is the things like the R&D offset tax deductibility that we had, 150% at one stage. That's been scrapped. I like to see that brought back, but also in a better form than it was before. It was almost like it was very difficult to actually get any funding through R&D for small business. That was my observation. It was a lot of work for often, sometimes very little return. And of course, the other issue is things like with the National Broadband Network and other initiatives, there's going to be innovation coming out of the ears of people. New businesses arising, making use of this new infrastructure. And what is lacking is venture capital in this country. We've seen Atlassian being bought out by venture capitalists, or
funded over in California. That's a tragedy for Australia, that we don't have the capital markets here.
A lot of our research does go overseas as a result.
Mm, exactly. We have one thing, this is off the top of my head, this is not Democrat policy, but even you think of our super fund, we have enormous super funds. So if we could have some sort of guidance that, venture capital is high risk, but super funds are long term. So there needs to be some mechanism where it's okay prudentially to invest in higher risk ventures, even if it was half of 1% of the super funds available out there. It would be a significant boost to available funds for small businesses trying to do some research and development.
Well, Anthony David, Senate candidate for the Australian Democrats for the federal election, good luck on Saturday, and I'd like to thank you for your time today.
Thank you very much, Preston.
And that was Anthony David from the Australian Democrats. Just to complete the picture that we have from the response from the Democrats, do you have any final remarks about what we've heard today so far?
Actually focus on science, because they're not, a lot of the time they're not going to do that off their own bat. So it's sort of, it's nice to get some answers that are so focused, and it gives you a lot of things to think about.
So if you were a swinging voter at the moment,
yeah,
and you hadn't made your mind up about who you were voting for, and you heard those responses, what was the most impressive to you?
It is a cliche, but I did like the Greens' responses. They just seemed more well thought through, I thought. And I think they're actually at the point where they think they can implement these things, and they're sort of in that mindset, whereas maybe the other smaller parties that are, they do have the passion for science, they sort of maybe have the mindset that, it might not happen yet, so they're not as well formed.
You've heard all the responses, listeners, so take out of that what is important to you. Talk to your local members, harass your party of choice and get their opinions on topics that are important to you. For me, science is very important, education is very important. Aside from education and science, there's a lot of associated policies as well, so climate change, sustainability. We have a minister for water in Australia, so all the stuff about water, health, even down to what we do in terms of immigration policy and so on, these come back to having a fundamental understanding of science. And so what I'm looking for are those people or parties who will support science and help Australia in the future, because it's going to be the basis of our economic strength. So that's my editorial comment. Take from that what you will. Good luck with all the politicians who responded on Saturday at the federal election. And Bec Crew, I'd like to thank you for your time today.
No problem at all.
And just quickly, very last minute, I got this response from the Citizens Electoral Council this morning, and I'll just run through them without making any particular comment on it. You can listen to it, make your own mind up, but I'll run through the answers that were provided by Doug Mitchell from CEC. Question 1, personal views on the importance of science in society. His response was, science is indispensable to the life of every human being. Everyone should live day by day, impassioned with a mission to discover the principles which govern the universe. I'm a full-time member of the LaRouche Youth Movement, which is working on science from Plato through Nicholas of Cusa, Johannes Kepler, Gottfried Leibniz, Carl Friedrich Gauss, Bernhard Riemann, Albert Einstein, Vladimir Vernadsky, and Lyndon LaRouche. This is what I'll bring into society. Question 2 on defence budget versus renewable energy sources. His response was, because renewable energy would be more expensive than that defence budget. Wind power requires more energy to produce one wind turbine than the energy that one wind turbine produces. Solar power will create more deserts and heat up the earth with all the land that's required to put the solar panels. If you want renewable energy, go for nuclear and thorium power. With the PBMR, uranium is recyclable. Question 3 about the percentage of GDP spent on education and science. His response was, This would ultimately make you demoralised and restrict the freedom to carry out scientific and research work. Only until the world economy is put into bankruptcy, reorganisation under a global Glass-Steagall, then we can create a government bank which will provide the funding for science and education. Question 4 about the lack of support for science and research. He responded with, my questions to answer 1 and 3 apply here. Question 5 on fundamental research. His response was, we owe our very existence to Albert Einstein. We need to produce more Einsteins today in society. Everyone has the potential to be the next one. The rarely acknowledged greatness of Einstein is that his scientific work was fueled and enriched by his love of classical music, particularly Mozart. A colleague of mine in the LYM, Shauna Halevy, recently made an excellent video called The Genius of Albert Einstein. This documents this love of music. Question 6 about promoting science. His response was, destroy Isaac Newton, the Babylonian priesthood, peer review method, and environmentalism. Discover the method of Johannes Kepler. Given lack of time, I can't elaborate much right here now, but you can begin by working through Kepler's Mysterium Cosmographicum, the new astronomy and harmonies of the world. Replicate the method of discovery. The last question about so few politicians having a basic understanding of science, and his response was, because they are baby boomers, the children born past World War II, rejected science in the 1960s, counterculture under a fear of a nuclear war. They don't believe truth exists. Everyone has a right to their own opinion. They are governed by liberalism. You can't know the principles which govern the universe. How to address it? Get the LYM to teach them Kepler. If that seems impossible, elect me as senator and bring Lyndon LaRouche into the White House. So that was a response from the Citizens Electoral Council. I'll let you make your own mind up about that one. As I mentioned, that was last minute, so Bec didn't hear the response to that. And the interview with Anthony David was pre-recorded as well, so Beck's final comment didn't include listening to that interview. So I'd like to thank everyone for listening, and vote well tomorrow for those in Australia and those overseas. I hope it's given you a good understanding of science and science policy in Australia. Bye for now. Thanks for listening to the show. You can check out the BrainsMatter website at www.brainsmatter.com. That's www.brainsmatter.com. And you can find all the other episodes of the show there. Just click on the podcast link on the right hand side. You can listen to the episodes from your browser by choosing Flash Player from the links and selecting whichever episode you want to hear from within the player. There's also other information on the site, such as links to articles and news, subscription details, both via iTunes and manually, and voting information. Please vote for the podcast on Podcast Alley, and remember to vote every month, since the votes reset at the start of each month. If you want to support the show, have a look at the Support the Show link. You can make a donation via PayPal, or you can buy a book through one of the Amazon links on the support page. If you have any comments or suggestions, you can leave an entry on this episode's show notes on the webpage, or you can send me an email. All my contact information can be found on the site. The theme music Future is performed by Cut Copy and comes courtesy of Glenn Gertz from Modular Records. I hope you enjoyed the show. Bye for now.